today's weigh-in is brought to you by our stable of sponsors. Yeehaw, Emily!
Baby, when I met you, there was peace unknown. I set out to get you with a fine-tooth comb. I was soft inside. There was something going on. You do something to me that I can't explain. Hold me closer and I feel no pain. Every beat of my heart, we got something going on. Tender love is blind. It requires a dedication. All this love we feel needs no conversation. We ride it together, making love with each other. Islands in the stream, that is what we are. No one in between. How can we be wrong? Sail away with me to another world. And we rely on each other. From one lover to another.
I can't live without you if the love.
A very relaxing start to this week's edition of Weigh In. Great to have your company on the show this morning. Michael Guerra not available to be with us this week. Butch Castles stepping into his shoes. Looking forward to getting into some of the big races throughout the weekend.
Yeah, for sure. And of course, the highlight there, the courtesy Ford Manawatu Sires produce. Good to see a good colt get the job done. But yeah, stepping in for Michael's, no doubt gallivanting somewhere around the world, I would suspect.
I think it's the English sales this week
in Sydney.
Many people within our industry across the ditch at the moment for the sales in Sydney. For now, though, let's get into our racing review. And we start, as Butch said, with the Group 1 feature from the weekend. It was, of course, the courtesy Ford Manawatu Sires Produce Stakes.
Full force, Valacious just held up slightly as they go for home in the size. Captured by Love alongside Red Sea. Spratt looking to get out with Valacious. Then came Full Force. No room, Valacious. It's captured by Love, Red Sea. And now down the outside, Move to Strike has joined in. Archaic Smile from a mile back. Move to Strike, it's the lead. Another size for the Tangerine. It's the I Am Invincible Colt.
Congrats, Billy. How did the horse travel on the run for you?
Yeah, really good. He doesn't breathe that well. He actually jumped out the gates and I could have been positive and got a posse midfield somewhere, but I just wanted to keep him relaxed. And he's got a really good turn of foot. He's a superstar. I think, you know, next time in, he'll just win Group 1 after Group 1. He's got such a great attitude and a really electric turn of foot. So, no, it was a good win. And I'd just like to thank Tiaka for all the opportunities that they've been giving me as well. Obviously, I started my apprenticeship there and it didn't end very well, so I'm very grateful for the second chance. So, this means a lot to me. I missed most of the big races this season by being suspended, so I'm relieved, yeah.
Yeah, it must be great to be able to get that Group 1 winning feeling again, actually, to be honest with you.
Yeah, it is. It's been a while. I think Mascarpone was my first and last one, but when Opie's back, he'll probably jump back on this fella, but I might have to have a word to them about that.
Yeah, you got to make the most of when he's over in Australia. Well, the race was always going to be good speed in the race. That was always going to help him because he's got that good turn of foot at the end of the race and good acceleration, and we saw that today.
Yeah, really good. I was just keeping an eye on Velocious and what she was doing. I actually sat on him for a while. I've been doing a bit of work with him and I knew what I had underneath me, and just like I said, he's got that real electric turn of foot and he can really put them away when you ask him.
Well done, Billy.
No, thanks. Appreciate it.
Yeah, it was a lovely win, wasn't it, by Move to Strike. And great to see him back at his best, because in the early part of the season, we heard plenty about Move to Strike and what the team thought of him. And good to see him getting that Group 1 on the resume. Sam Burgesson joins us on the phone this morning. And Sam, very good morning to you. And must be a real sigh of relief to have picked up the Group 1 with Move to Strike on the day.
Yeah, morning, guys. For sure. Like, obviously, being a young Palmy fella growing up there, I spent plenty of time at the track watching, the Group 1 Sires Produce growing up. And it's always been a race I've really wanted to win, being a local boy. And it was pretty special to win it with a horse like him. He's been very special from day one. You know, he's had to face a bit of adversity there with his heart at Matamata on his home track. And, you know, it was a great effort by everyone at home to get him there on Saturday in such good order after the step back. A huge thrill and a massive thanks to Bill as well. You know, he has been coming in and writing plenty of work for us while he's been suspended. And he's done a lot of work with this horse especially as well. So, you know, a massive thrill for everyone.
Yeah, you make a good point there about the adversity that Move to Strike has faced. It hasn't been easy, hasn't it? We've all known the opinion that the stable have had of him, but he's just taken a while to put it all together and for things to go his way.
Yeah, for sure. Like, ever since we've got him from day one, he's been a lovely animal and he's had a fantastic nature, and I think that's held him in really good stead the whole way through. Like, he trialled super early on. I think it was at Avondale, really early in his two-year-old season, and we gave him a bit more time, and then he was super at Tarapa, and then he was beaten a very short price favourite twice, and then sort of following Matamata, you know, we're obviously on the back foot, and there's a massive effort by the horse to come back. Obviously, we gave him a quiet time following Matamata, trialled him against the older horses, and Opie rode him, and he gave him the tick of approval, which obviously is a massive plus, having, you know, an opinion like his on him. And his work since had been super. Like, his work on Tuesday, Bill came in and rode him, and it was just like, it was just unbelievable work really for a two-year-old. So we're going in quietly confident, but then also sceptical, obviously, because we were confident at Matamata and at Pukekohe in the Eclipse, and it didn't quite come off. But obviously on Saturday it did, just very grateful to be a tiny part of it.
Sam Butch here, congratulations. Part of the job and part of the job description, no doubt, at Tiakau is turning these expensive yearling purchases into stallions, and this bloke fits that bill now. He's a Group 1 winner, so that's the first tick on the pathway to that stallion barn for him.
Yeah, exactly, for sure. It's obviously the main goal is to produce horses like him that end up in the stallion shed. And like I say, I think his nature would just watch sort of held him together. He's obviously got the physical, he's just a lovely animal. He's got the talent, but he's also got the brain. Like, he's just unbelievable to have at home. You know, the team in the colt barn especially, but everyone at home done a fantastic job with him. And the young fella strapping him as well, Colin Collett, you know, he's just a pleasure to have around. And he's, you know, a young fella with a bright future. And he's done a lot of work with this horse, and he's always kept the faith. So a massive kudos to him as well.
Sam, what do you do next? Because I know there's some pretty lucrative targets in Australia in a Queensland Winter Carnival race like the JJ Atkins. Do you put him away, or do you press on towards some of those?
Nah, so he's on the bus today to Tiakau studies for a well-deserved break. You know, it is a big trip down there at Wellington, especially for those young horses. You know, he got home and he trotted out well this morning, but he was pretty tired. They got home very late Saturday night, and he deserves a rest, I think. You know, he has had a big season. Like I say, he did trial there really early on in the season at Avondale. He's still going now, but he sort of was showing us signs that he had enough there over the weekend. So, well-deserved break for him.
And what about Captured by Love? What were your thoughts on the run of her? She sort of did all the donkey work, didn't she, leading up the rest of the field?
Yeah, still really great game, but very proud of her. She, like you say, she did lead the field up. Grilsey sort of thought, you know, the last 100 metres, maybe the season had taken a toll on her, and she was just all out, just couldn't quite get past the Forsman runner there, and then obviously Bomb Lake by Move to Strike as well. But, you know, she was game as ever, still so proud of her, and she's off for a well-deserved break as well.
Talking of well-deserved breaks, Imperatrice is having one of those too. Sam, what was your take on her effort on Saturday in the TJ Smith?
Yeah, still obviously very proud of her. You know, she finished fourth, but beaten not very far. She probably didn't look like the winner up the straight, but was still very game. And just speaking to Opie as well, probably Zach Purden's mount, sort of, obviously, it's very competitive riding over there. He sort of had to jostle his way out, which is what has cost him the suspension. It has probably cost her finishing a little bit closer. But like I said, probably no excuses. You know, she tried her heart out on very testing ground. It's been a great season for her. She's won 5 Group 1s for us, and we're so proud. And, you know, happy to have her here back on home soil, enjoying some time out.
Yeah, I bet. Sam, a huge weekend for you. And as you said, a Group 1 that you were really excited to win. Well done with Move to Strike and onwards and upwards into the new season.
Awesome. Thanks, Emily. Thanks for having me.
Great feedback from Sam there. And Move to Strike aside, what did you make of Velocious and some of the other runners in the field?
Yeah, look, I thought there were some good runs in there. Red Sea was really good. Mm. He was very brave, 1,400 metres. He did a fair bit of work. And to get up onto the pace, it's amazing, isn't it? Red Sea, they thought he was good from the word go. They thought he'd probably win his first start, and he ran into Velocious in a two-year-old maiden race at Tarapa. So that form, Velocious, she didn't have all of the favours in the straight. I don't think they're making any excuses, though. And, look, she was good enough late in the race. She did get held up. Thought a really good run from Sergeant Major. I know he was sold for big money to Aussie Care, racing in Aussie's colours there. And I think if you watch him the last bit, he was really very good after getting held up. It was quite tight. They did race close to the rail, and I think that was certainly beneficial to Move to Strike. Clear air, Whittemu said that he wanted to keep his breathing going, had him in the clear air, and I think that it's fantastic to see Whittemu. He is such a talent, but clearly there are some issues and have been some issues. I know that Tiakia are giving him that second chance, a bit of a project, if you like, for Mark Walker, and look, he's repaying them. He repaid them with a very good ride, doing all that track work. But let's just hope that he can put some of those demons away, because we need him out there riding like that. We need a young rising star in the saddle to be doing what he is so very good at. And let's just hope that break, that enforced break over those. And it sounded like he knew as well. It sounded like that he was hungry, the fact that he sat out most of the summer and has got that win. I reckon that'll stand by him.
Yeah, and from an NZB Kiwi perspective, obviously the Manawatu Sires Produce is a bonus race. You've got the next bonus race.
Yeah, we do. Well, all bets are off. No bonus up, of course. That one not eligible. But yes, the Sarton is the next of them. So that'll be really interesting as to how things play out early in the season with the Hawke's Bay Guineas and then to the Sarton to see who can be the first to qualify for that $1 million worth of bonuses for the NZB Kiwi. It's just going to be fascinating. Mm. A horse like Move to Strike, no doubt, will target the 2,000 guineas for his resume. Not eligible for the NZB Kiwi, but here's the market, and why wouldn't it be a loose favourite at this time? Velocious, interesting Red Sea in there at $21. There'll be horses that aren't even named yet.
I
think Tocanto hasn't been to the races. I don't think it may have trialled. Some friends of mine had a share and they wanted a price. So they got the $31 and they'll sit on that through to the NZB Kiwi, hoping that they get a slot.
Yeah, it's fascinating stuff. Can't wait to see how it all unfolds. And as we said, it's potentially horses we haven't even had a chance to look at that are going to be our key contenders when it comes to the NZB Kiwi. Let's move on to some of the other features on the program from Trentham. And we start with the Alpuni Gold Cup. This one won by Nereus.
As they go for home, 400 metres to go. Skyman booted away. Skyman three lengths in front now from Nereus giving chase. He's a doozy's running on down the outside. Skyman, the middle, Nereus the outside. He's a doozy is storming home. In the middle, Nereus takes the lead. Here's the toppy, he's a doozy, but Nereus, the up and comer, burst to the lead and is going on to win the City of Palmerston North Aupuni Gold Cup. Nereus just...
Congratulations, Sean. Race panned out beautifully. You must have been really giggling with the spot that Joe was able to get in.
Yeah, exactly. Look, gun ride. We've had Michael McNabb riding him, and he's been doing the same thing. It's nice when you're in the 1-1 in any race and you're going to get your chance, and these good jockeys always do it.
You came here when we spoke to you pre-race, just a little concerned about track conditions, but he looks like he's a real winner though at the same time, isn't he, this horse?
He really is, isn't he? Like, he's a very, very good horse. You know, he could even be one of the... Well, he might be the best one in the stable. He's definitely better on top of the ground. He lets down much better, much quicker. But, you know, I think we've got some exciting times ahead, and those colours hopefully are to the fore again this afternoon.
Yeah, well, you spoke around maybe the future and what's coming up. This race fitted in best as opposed to a Hawke's Bay Cup. So does Australia beckon through the autumn?
Well, the reason we dodged the Hawke's Bay Cup, and as a trainer, you don't want to throw them in the deep end too quick, and it wasn't the right race for him today with the set weights and penalties conditions. But in 2 weeks' time, there's a Mornington Cup, and if we can get in that race, it's taking a leaf out of Roger James's book. It's a golden ticket to the Caulfield Cup. And he's a nifty little horse. He's not big, and I think he'll get around Mornington and Caulfield well. And if he keeps raising the bar, and if he keeps lifting it and keeps getting over it, then we've got some exciting times.
Yeah, and it looks like you've got the right sort of horse to not be afraid and have a go at a race like that.
He's got the lot. He's got the pedigree. He's got the temperament, and he's got that will to win.
Congratulations.
Thanks very much, Tay.
Joe, congratulations. The race panned out beautifully for you.
Yeah. What can I say? That was the plan. Well done to Colm and Sean. He's a lovely little horse, that horse. He's not very imposing to look at, but he's got a big heart and he tries very hard. So, look, it was just a really smooth run round, and I couldn't have been happier with the run I got. Delighted, and well done to Waikato Stud as well. It's obviously fantastic for them.
When you got that position and you're able to push the go button with him, I'm sure you were looking out wide, but with He's a Doozy coming into the race, you know, a good, tough staying horse himself, and he presented a challenge, but boy, this horse was able to fight him off, and it looks like a horse that's got a little bit in front of him.
I'd say so. He's got a big heart. He's certainly on the improve, and if anybody can get a bit of improvement out of him, it's Sean and Colm.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
He's a lovely little horse, isn't he, Nereus? And I just love the way he's been working his way through the grades and doing it with ease. As we heard from Sean, it wasn't necessarily the most suitable race. It was a big jump for him from what he had done at his last start. But he won it, and it was the old versus the young, wasn't it, with He's a Doozy closing late, Nereus getting the better of him.
Yeah, he's a very good horse. Look, we saw him beaten in the Rimutaka Classic just on an off track. He was super that last time at Trentham. He was given a gun ride here. He's only getting a kilo off Skyman, so progressive horse winning his fifth win, having his fifth win from just eight starts, only getting a kilo off a horse like Skyman. He's a Doozy, ran up to sort of try and go past him, but he's a properly good racehorse. He's a classic example of what the increased stake money has done in New Zealand racing. He's a horse that Mark Chittick would have sold this time last year, or when he got offers for him a year ago without the stake money to run for, but he's won $200,000 in his last three starts in New Zealand. He ran second in the Rimutaka Classic. He then won a $65,000 rating race, and then he's won $100,000 on Saturday. So I think last time I was on here, we spoke about it. The decisions to sell these horses are so much harder now that you can run for decent money. And that's a fantastic thing for New Zealand racing.
Yeah, it is. And a lovely pedigree this horse has as well, obviously related to Savvy Cope. The family doing great things. Eudora, the Waikato Stud, will be pretty chuffed with that.
Yeah, absolutely. And they do race a few of these geldings, but they are trading horses as a rule. But Mark put a line in the sand and said, no, he's going to race this bloke, and he's being rewarded. And as Sean said, they've got a target in Australia. Winning that race will certainly help them get into the Mornington Cup, because before that, you know, like he'd only been running races. But now he should, on the strength of that Group 2 win, get that run in Australia, and no reason why he can't be nifty around Mornington. And then that golden ticket kicks in like it did for Mark Twain.
Yeah, I spoke to Sean Ritchie this morning just to check everything was okay with Nereus post-race, and he said pulled up well, licked the bowl, and the Mornington Cup is most definitely on the horizon. So exciting stuff for them, and could that be a ticket into the Caulfield Cup? Fingers crossed it can be for the connections of Nereus. Let's get along to our next race, and we highlight a first stakes victory for Apostrophe in the Manawatu Breeders' Stakes.
Royal Flower went up quickly. Royal Flower hit the lead. Coming after it out, Jamala. Just as dramatic down the outside, and then Apostrophe. They're across the track, 200 metres to go. Our Jamala, Apostrophe, the outside, just as dramatic. Apostrophe surge to the lead, though, in the final 100 metres. Coming away, and Apostrophe is going to be too strong to beat our Jamala.
The race panned out okay. I mean, they were never going to go breakneck speed, but the horse seemed to be travelling kindly at the back there for Musa.
Yeah, exactly. We're sort of probably a little bit worried about it being a slowly run race, but with it only being a nine-horse field, you're never going to get too far off them. And then a bit of pressure came on the turn. She's able just to sort of come up and behind them, and when she got a gap, she was electric.
She really did have the right runs on the board to suggest she was going to be hard to beat. You would have come here with enough confidence believing that with what we saw in the Cuddle and a couple of other races this preparation.
Yeah, she's sort of been screaming out to go over 2,000 her whole life, and we've never got her there through one thing or another, and finally have, and she was very good. So very special. Jim's been an owner for Roger for 30 years. We were just looking through the book and thinking he won with Spotswood in 2000, the Manawatu Classic. So he's been with the stable a long time, and it's very special to get it with this mare. A lot of work's gone into her, and always good to get results for people that put in.
Yeah, totally. A good target race. Is there much left for a horse like this now in this preparation?
Look, there may be one other mare's race at Tarapa over 2000 as well, but she's probably destined for the broodmare paddock after this this preparation, so perhaps one more run, but I'd say that's about it.
So apostrophe there, getting a well-deserved success. And she's another who's been racing pretty regularly at Trentham over the latter part of the season, and she really deserved that because she's come with some great barnstorming runs, but everything just went to plan over the 2000.
Yeah, it did. She got the gap at the right time. Masahasa Zumi is a much-improved rider in the riding ranks in the north. He really is seizing the opportunities that he's getting. Look, this is dramatic. If she just had her rolled in there, Massa waited, the gap came about. Now, if you look at Val De Soldo, though, pretty unlucky in the pike colours back on the fence, not taking anything away from the winner. When you watch the head on, there was half a gap. Michael nearly exposed himself to it, but it closed before he could, and then she's hit the line really strongly. I would imagine that Val De Soldo will press on to the Travis as well, you would think, on the strength of that, but gee, she'd be hard to beat, apostrophe. She can be your own worst enemy at times out of the barriers, but she was much better on Saturday and able to be given a gun ride in transit and got the job done pretty comprehensively.
We were talking to Robert Wellwood this morning, weren't we, in the green room, and he said, suggested that she could be their new racing manager. A little text was sent on Saturday to suggest that Travis Stakes would be a good aim for apostrophe.
Yeah, well, I did hear him say maybe a race at Tarapa coming up, so I thought I'd better cement that and send him a text and say that'd be just ideal for her. But it would, so look, it's just up the road, so I suspect strongly that that's where she'll head.
Yep, and then they indicated potentially the broodmare paddock after that. But let's move along to the next replay that we look at, and it is for the three-year-olds, the Manawatu Classic, and it was won by Out of Stock.
Magic as they go for home. Still Sheaf, the filly with a bit of a kick, two lengths clear. Here's the favourite giving chase, Just As Sharp. Black Betty the inside, further back Investigate, and Out of Stock's coming home with a really good run. Down the outside, bounded up to Just As Sharp. Out of Stock and Just As Sharp, Investigate tied it up, but it's Out of Stock for the Oaks winning trainer. Ormsby does it again on the champagne turf. Out of Stock, brilliant. Out of Stock, won it from Investigate.
Yeah, what a Michael, a horse who was just coming through different form lines on the rise and gets the job done nicely.
Yeah, good one. Yeah, he's coming through a sort of odd midweek into a very wet Saturday. But he showed good staying credentials the other day on that track, and today with the better track he had a really good turn of foot.
Right. Travelled well on the run?
Yeah, probably too well. Obviously only his second start over ground. He wants to overdo it a little bit, but picked up well, which was the main thing.
Trainer's doing a great job with these colours as well. Of course, here winning in Oaks not too long ago. He's doing a great job as Chad.
Yeah, he's a super horseman, extremely hard worker. So he deserves these big wins because the work he does and his passion for educating younger horses and what he does, he deserves every bit of these big races wins, success he gets.
Yeah, well spoken by Michael there, because it's very true what Chad does, educating young horses, and as we've heard many times, such a skilled horseman. And the stable's absolutely flying. Butch Pulchritudinous, of course, taking out the Oaks. Out of Stock, a really nice progressive type. I spoke to him this morning and he said the South Australian Derby is potentially on the horizon. They looked at the Queensland Derby, but the South Australian Derby is sort of the natural progression. So that's where they're going to head, but plenty of interest with regards to a sale. So still TBC when it comes to Out of Stock.
Yeah, I'm sure there will be plenty of interest in regards to a sale. Chad got the money for Pulchritudinous. Look, he is very brave when it comes to the yearling sales. If they don't make their money, if they're ready to run sale, if they don't make their money, Chad is prepared to take them home and turn them into a racehorse, and he's done it with Pulchritudinous. He's done it with this bloke as well. Look, he was really good on Saturday. Spoke to Michael McNabb on Friday on Breakfast with the Kiwis, a radio show that I do, and he was quietly confident on the strength that he would improve out of that first run on a wet track over ground at Tauranga, and gee, showed a turn of foot. Yes, he did tighten them up, Investigate, the fourth horse, Moonlight Magic as well, got tightened up as well. There was an inquiry. I think Michael got suspended for careless riding, but he put them away in three or four hops, and if Chad is able to keep him, if the money's not at the right level, then I'm sure he'll be very competitive in what will be a $1 million race in South Australia, so why not have a crack? but you get the impression a horse like that, there'll be tons of people circling to buy him, and Chad knows how to get the right money for them.
Yeah, and I think the upcoming South Australian Racing Carnival is going to have plenty of Kiwi interest, as we know, because now with the prize money up, it's a slightly easier option than a Queensland winter, and if you've got a fit horse, why not jump across the ditch? And Kiwi's been going so well of late.
Yeah, well, Antrim Coast, he's a prime example. He's gone to Melbourne, he's had those two runs. I think he goes for that same race. Quasi Alfaresha, my understanding is she'll go to South Australia for the Oaks after placing at Trentham. So, yeah, you're right. And look, it's all about the money, isn't it? We just spoke about the increased money in New Zealand and what that's done. And I'm sure there'll be increased interest out of Melbourne to head down to Adelaide for what have been some boosted stake money races for that carnival.
Yeah, and got to make a special mention to Tavistock as well, because the sire of Apostrophe and the sire of Out of Stock, he's had a real red letter day on Saturday.
He has, and just underlines what a loss he is to the industry and what a loss he'll be. I'm sure he'll be a wonderful broodmare sire as well, and we're just starting to see that. So Apostrophe will be well sought when she either is sold or goes to the broodmare paddock, and then her progeny will be well sought after.
Yeah, they sure will. Let's move along to the last of our features from Trentham, and it was, of course, the Flying Handicap. This one was won by Bradman.
If in doubt, get out underneath our echo. Bradman starting to arrive up the middle, then Duncan Creek, and from a long way back, Provence is leading down with a run. Over on the outside, she's coming with a great run. Bradman, Provence, and our echo. The three of them draw clear. It's our echo, Bradman. Bradman gets the head in front, Provence. But Bradman will win. Bradman won it to be Provence in third.
Congratulations. Wins at a big price, informed jockey, and gets the job done. Well done.
Yeah, it's been a good day for the family, to be fair. Look, he's always been a good horse. It's just he's been a work in motion, and look, I'd like to thank my staff at home. They do a hell of a lot of work to quiet him down, but you know, Bruce rides in most of his track work, and he said he's finally starting to learn how to race. And look, his full brother won a Group 1 2-mile race, so and he's winning sprints like this, you know, like, and he's always been a good horse, but he's just been a work in motion. And it's bloody good to see that today.
Yeah, a real good honest horse. Look, you're only three lengths off our echo last time out in the Lightning over 1,200 metres.
Look, he should have beat Tavitak at Otaki. If he had run straight, he'd have beaten Tavitak. And, you know, Tavitak was the favourite today. I thought, there's not much between them, you know. Like, no, it's great.
Yeah, Royden Burgesson talking there, and it was a pretty good family day out for the Burgessons, and great that Royden was on track to be able to witness Sam's Group 1 winner with Move to Strike. Talk about Bradman, and I had a chat with Royden this morning. The racing manners have just been so costly, and now he's sort of finally settling and putting it all together. We can see the ability that he's got, and they're going to head towards the Anzac Metric Mile on Anzac Day. That'll be the next target.
Look, anything the son can do, the father can do nearly as well as well. Not quite as well, Royden.
No.
Not quite as well, Royden. That was only your Group 3, was it, or something?
Listed
even. Yeah. The son won the Group 1. So you're not quite on top of the Burgesson family tree on Saturday, but you're somewhere there, and done a great job with Bradman. Yeah, look, it took him a long time to string a couple of wins together. He was placing. But now the penny may well have dropped, and he did that well. Look, there's space back to the fourth horse. The Provence was really good at her first step up in company. She's got that black type now as well, so that's going to be helpful for her. But congratulations to Royden and the team. Well done. He'll be watching, and you're not quite the top male in the Burgesson family just yet.
We said we'd give him a shout out. Sorry, Royden. Not fair today, is it? Sam can win a race on another day. For the mare, Baggy Green as well. Tafane, Benno, No Compromise. Unbelievable family.
Yeah, it is an unbelievable family. And look, this bloke, there's more wins in store for him, for sure.
Yeah. Let's get you to Pukekohe, because that was the other meeting on Saturday. And we start with Rudyard, a dramatic running of the 1,300 metre event.
One more time, tackled by Trigon Lad. Two lengths away, next warming up now, Rudyard. Coming with a devastating New Jersey down the outskirts of the track. And behind these, Beep Beep and battling away also, is that so? Good battle developing here. New Jersey out wide, swept to the lead now. Coming with it, things getting tight here, Devastate. And also there as well as Rudyard, it's New Jersey wants to lay in. And diving at it, late rod on the line, Rudyard to make it interesting. This is close here. either Rudyard or...
So you can see there from the post-race vision that it was pretty tight in the closing stages and plenty unfolded post this race, Butch.
You did. You do. I just wanted to lay in the last little bit. That's a dead heat. Is the way that it was declared with Rudyard and New Derzo. Devastate's gone a really good race as well, but then the inquiry room, I suspect it was a pretty easy decision when they've dead-heated, because all there needs to be is a zigzag paper as far as the interference goes in the mind of the panel, and they've been able to find that. But yeah, you're just feeling physically unwell if you're on New Derzo. First you have to cop the fact you've dead-heated, and then you have to cop the fact you've run second. All three of those will head to the Easter, you would think. Mm. That's the logical pathway for them. And look, they'll all be very competitive as well. They're horses that have come through the grades this preparation. Yeah. New Derzo, Devastate resuming there after racing in really good company as a three-year-old. And look, I think all those three will be pretty competitive, as will another bloke that won on that card, Chattahoochee. He's a good horse.
Yeah, really like Chattahoochee. He's one I've had an eye on for a little while. What about Yaldi? This was in earlier in the program. Race number two, Yaldi delivered the goods for the punters.
To the big trash, back and behind these Osteria, followed further away by Maya Bay, out wider to Rock Mark 2, and then Magna Memory, down to the 300 metres they come, and the leader is Yaldi, leads a length and a half of Montana Bay, Windrush, looking to warm up late as Magna Memory through the centre from Osteria, but it's Yaldi in front at the 100 metres, the money was right on the lolly on debut, and he's just cruised it in too. Yaldi will win it second, was Windrush, photos for third.
Very professional performance for a debut start, and the money came, poured in, and it was well found, because it hit the mark and was a very comfortable watch if you had the money on.
Yeah, he'd been unbeaten at the trials. He'd looked really good too on the synthetic one at Taupo. It was the old instruction, just go to the front and increase the lead, really. He is... well, he's a lovely big son of Ardrossan, isn't he, who continues to do a good job. He doesn't strike you as a natural of a two-year-old, no, but he does strike you as a horse that's going to go on with it. So there's a series of two-year-old races coming up in the north, the first at 1,200 in a couple of weeks, then 14 at Tarapa, and then a mile back at Ellerslie. So they might pick one of those, or two of them even, to take him, and then I'm sure put aside. And talked about the NZB Kiwi earlier, the Forsman stable have, they purchased a slot, so he's one of them that at this early stage that they might have on their radar as one that might progress that way.
Yeah, exactly right. And we've got, as you said, that two-year-old series coming up. We can certainly have a little look at those and keep the NZB Kiwi at the back of our minds. That's the first segment done and dusted. We'll be back to go through day one of the championships on the back of this.
I'll bet you never.
Today's weigh-in is brought to you by our stable of sponsors.
Ball Don't Lie goes past inside the final eighth of a mile. Santa Arena is fighting bravely. Ball Don't Lie is just a little too good, though. And Ball Don't Lie wins going away. Santa Arena second, Winterfell third in front of Tour Player in Canada Gate. Cinto Rompere on the outside up to take the lead, a 16th out. And it's another for Frankie Dettori as Recinto Rompere wins it by two. Alternate Rock rallied well to get the play spot. It's Roberta's Love who keeps on going. Safa on the chase. Roberta's Love has won the evening jewel presented by the Thoroughbred Aftercare Alliance. But in the meantime, Frankie Dettori's on fire, and Kathy and Marissa has come to take the lead. And it's going to be four in a row for the legend, Frankie Dettori. Kathy and Marissa wins convincingly. Lottery second. She's the Law, Certitude. Behind that, between Tahini and Poppy's Joy. Nothing Like You and Frankie Dettori turning the Santa Anita Oaks into a romp. What a tremendous performance from Nothing Like You, who wins by eight widening lengths. Kinza second, Corposo third, then Copian. Frankie Dettori, simply unstoppable. Here comes Royal Charter and Frankie Dettori on the outside. And Royal Charter's up to take the lead, a 16th to go. Six in a row for the amazing Frankie Dettori, Royal Charter by Three. This story today is simply about Frankie Dettori.
Well, retirement looks pretty good on Frankie. He has relocated to the States and he rides a sixth time, and we know he can do amazing things, and he continues to do those even the twilight of his career.
That's just a freak show, isn't it? You know, like, he's just an extraordinary athlete. As you say, he was retired. He sold all the trophies, sold up, moved to the States, and look what he can do. Six in a row. You're just quite incredible to watch, and he's lost none of that verve, none of that vigour, none of that showmanship that we know him for. And just incredible to watch.
Yeah, it is incredible to watch. And what he's done for racing, I mean, he'd be the most well-known racing figure in the world. Remarkable stuff is Frankie Dettori. And fingers crossed he can keep up the winning ways in the States. Let's get into our review of the Australian racing. And we start with the ATC Derby. This one won by Riff Rocket.
Plenty of pressure. Then came Gambare, Riff Rocket slicing through the pack. He's got the run now of Good Enough. Glad You Think So, a dominant leader at the 250, but Riff Rocket's eating up the ground, and here's Chaowulf. Chaowulf wide out, coming with a big run. Riff Rocket through the middle. Chaowulf wide out. It's Riff Rocket and Chaowulf in a great derby finish. Riff Rocket, Chaowulf, nothing in this. Riff Rocket just in front, clings on. Riff Rocket beat Chaowulf. Glad You Think So.
Congratulations.
Thank you. This is phenomenal. I don't really know what else to say. James, I know.
James just said more money for the Winx filly to buy her back.
Oh, look. No,
she's got to come home, James.
It's an Oxton. But this is absolutely fabulous. This horse, to do what he did today, he was slipping and sliding. He jumped out and he slid as he jumped out. And then you could see him over the back, slipping as he's trying to come through. He doesn't give in. He's got a heart like Winx.
Have you heard of Dulcify and Mahogany and Hitotsu? Your horse becomes the fourth horse in history to complete the double, and with those famous names.
I know, and that Cerise didn't. No, look, that's very important. History is what you go for. It's all written there. And to see him do this is just unbelievable. We just didn't know that we had an animal like that. And this genius man here, without him, I don't know what we'd be up to.
Well, guess what, Deb? Your horse has just given this man his first Australian Derby.
One of
two races that have eluded you. You've won a Victoria Derby and you've done it a couple of times now, but your hometown Derby.
Pretty special. Yeah, simple as that. And these guys were here before I had the first Group 1 winner, so, yeah, it's fitting, as you can tell.
Yeah,
I don't cry as much as I used to, but this one's pretty special.
But it should be special.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, racing special. Just racing today. 5 o'clock this morning didn't look good, did it?
Not at all. You're going to have to wait a week for it to win a derby.
So the team at Randwick have done an amazing job. James has done a great job, and my team, they were there in the pouring rain the last few days. Do a great job.
You think he's a stayer now? You were still umming and ahhing whether you'd run a mile and a half.
Good rides like that, it's a big help.
Yeah.
He's a genius.
And here he is with Corey. Well done.
Well done, J-Mac. How tough is this horse?
Oh, you'd love him with war. He wears his heart on his sleeve. He's as solid as a rock. He doesn't know how to run badly. I want to say he's just got a fantastic will to win, but he's not the sharpest tool in the shed.
Were you ever concerned?
I was at the 300, because he didn't spend a penny getting there, but I could feel he was out on his feet. Like, the distance range is as far as he wants. So the will to win, tenacity to find a line is incredible.
Great training effort. You know, Victoria Derby, now Sydney Derby.
He does it all the time, doesn't he? He's a master. But it's good to be riding for him.
Well done, mate.
Thanks.
It was a Kiwi success, wasn't it, across the ditch with Riff Rocket. And it is not an easy thing to do, to have a three-year-old to be able to run a VRC Derby and come back and take out an ATC Derby. But, Chris Waller, you never doubt what he can do with his training ability.
No, you don't. That's only three have done it previously. Dulcify, Mahogany and Hitotsu. Only the three of them that have done that. And as Debbie sort of had a wee little cheeky shot at the Cerise, couldn't do it. And they would have won a number in either of them. Mm. So, look, yeah, James, he said at the 300 he was worried. He was out on his feet, but just showed a tremendous will to win. The horse coming home strongly, Chow Wolf, momentarily looked like he might get there.
Yeah.
But that Waller touch has proved to be too good in the finish. And look, they've cleared out, haven't they? They've cleared out from the third horse. So a couple of pretty good horses going forward, I'm sure.
Yeah, let's now take a look at the TJ Smith. That's the next race that we get to. And this was filled with Kiwis. I wish I went. And Imperatory is the highlight in this next one.
Crusher move to a narrow lead. Bella Nepotina, it's go time for Bella. Up the inside is Chain of Lightning. Chain of Lightning, the grey, and Bella Nepotina. Magic Time running on. Imperatrice grinding. I Wish I Win is starting to launch his attack. And then came Sunshine in Paris. Chain of Lightning, Bella Nepotina. Chain of Lightning, Bella Nepotina. Chain of Lightning kicking. Chain of Lightning's won the TJ, beating Bella.
She becomes a forgotten horse with all the big names in the race.
Yeah, and she come in with some really strong form, peaking at the right time, confident she'd handle the ground. So she ticked a lot of boxes. Of course, you're never too confident when you come up against a field like this, but she acquitted herself really well.
Did you always feel the winner?
I did, actually. I just thought that maybe I pressed the button a touch early because I hit the Alex accelerator coming up the rise, and sometimes that's a touch too early here, but she gritted her teeth and knuckled down and did enough, which was... made it good.
What is it?
Thank you.
He was massive. He ran out of us again.
She just got held up momentarily for a couple of strides, but she ran through the line well.
Yeah, there was plenty to unpack when it came to the running of the TJ Smith. Chain of Lightning sort of flew under the radar. Wasn't a horse anybody even considered in pre-start market, and got the win, minding its own business in front. For us, obviously, the focus on the Kiwis. I Wish I Win. I think the track probably just found him out the last tiny little bit, but still a huge run. And Imperatrice was very brave, and as we said, strong through the line.
Yeah, she was. Look, Peter Moody, second stringer, not so bad when you're second stringer, can come out and get the job done. Look, I Wish I Win did look the winner momentarily, but just the fact he was fresh up on a track. Remarkable, the track, though. When you consider the rain they had, they're talking thereabouts 200 mils of rain in the 24 to 36 hours into the race, and they're running times that they did. Look at that track. It's just incredible, but probably just blunted him a little bit in that for that fresh-up run. I thought Imperatrice was super late through the line. She had every ride, if you like. She looked like she was going to run fifth, sixth or something at the 200-metre mark, but she just dug deep and got to the line. She didn't get all of the clear air, and I think her sprint blunted as well by an off track. No, I don't think anyone's using it as an excuse. She has had a remarkable campaign right through the spring. She then had that wee break and into the autumn. She's done everyone associated with her proud. Home in the paddock already, I understand. Yeah. So she'll have a break here, and then they'll no doubt pick a path to the spring and sort of campaign out as to where she goes next. Be interesting with I Wish I Win whether they go to the All Age. You would think that's probably on his dance card, and then maybe up to Queensland, and no doubt the Everest will be their target, and they'll find their way to the Everest in October again with him.
Yeah, and he went so close last year, didn't he? If he didn't have that draw down on the inside, you wonder if he could have maybe won the race. All to come, and it really makes it an exciting start to next season. Celestial Legend was the winner of the Doncaster Mile. Let's look at that replay now.
Fierce and Another Will is cruising up on the outside, and now Car Said Go and Another Will going after Think About It. Pericles stays on Will. Over on the inside, it's Militarized launching his attack, and further back to Obambiramai. Up the inside, Militarized, wide out Pericles. Pericles and Militarized fighting it out for the moment. Nugget bursting through, and here he is, Celestial Legend, bombing them wide out. Celestial Legend won the Doncaster, nailing, I think, Pericles.
Well, it's such a time-honoured race, isn't it, the Doncaster Mile, and Celestial Legend is a horse going places, a fantastic win. Tyler Schiller put in so much effort to be able to make the weight to ride Celestial Legend, but he just wins. He just finds a way to win every time. Back-to-back Group 1 victories, and for Les Bridge, gosh, what a result, and what a master trainer.
85 years old. 85 years old, and he got that job done. Just amazing. Tyler Schiller, he knocked out the KFC, I think I read somewhere. That was that was off the eating menu. I might have to do the same. But, look, son of your bloke, son of Dundee, who will no doubt find his home at stud somewhere out of a schnitzel mare. So he'll be highly sought after. Bonho, the legend racing syndicate, doing the ownership there. So, yeah, look, a hell of a ride as well. If you look where he was, he somehow found that gap between horses at about the 250-metre mark and then was strong through the line with the 49 kilos. So, yeah, wonderful effort.
Yeah, it was a huge effort. The last of the group ones that we highlight is Manal. This was, of course, the sires and Jason Collett doing the riding.
The colt, the cue. He knew being tackled by Traffic Warden, 250 to go. Then Storm Boy, Fearless. Manal's winding up on the outside and Coleman as well. Traffic Warden races to the lead. Storm Boy's in trouble. Traffic Warden being joined by Coleman. Manal wide out. It's Traffic Warden. Manal. Manal going to Traffic Warden. They're wide apart. They hit it. Oh, Manal's put a bob in. So did Traffic Warden.
Congratulations, Jace. I know that this horse means a lot to you.
Yeah, I was fortunate enough to pick her up in the slipper, and although she didn't win it, it felt like a win. I come back in and I could see the excitement in Michael's eyes and the team. Just, you know, she had an awful gait. So we went in today with confidence. Her work on Tuesday was the same as before going into the slipper. Again, she drew wide, but she was able to overcome it.
The wheels spun a little bit at the top of the straight?
They did. They went early, then they pulled up through the middle. I was sort of trying to hold Coleman in, but he's a big horse and I'm not, so he got out. and I just sort of then had to give her time, rebalance, and then I thought I might only have Coleman to beat, but Traffic Warden was still there, but luckily we got our nose down.
It's really special when you've got the family to enjoy it with you.
It is, yeah. They didn't think they were coming today, but then Claire came home from sports with the little one and said, we're going to the races, so yeah, this is awesome.
Well done, buddy.
Thank you.
Yeah, there was some great stuff on social media with his little daughter, and great to see them on track enjoying that Group 1 win. And Jason sort of, he doesn't fly under the radar. He does an amazing job. But James and Jason are two Kiwi jockeys we can be so incredibly proud of. And there's barely a week goes by that Jason Collett doesn't ride a Metropolitan winner or a Stakes winner.
No, somewhere near the top of the Sydney Premiership. And look, he'll be making an extraordinarily good living. He was just so unlucky when he did his apprenticeship in New Zealand that he was around at the same time as James, because any other year or any other sort of 2 year period, Jason Collett would have been a massive headline. He is a super talented jockey, absolutely no mistake about that. And look, as he said, the slipper, this filly was phenomenal in the slipper from the gate. She ran fifth, but the 1400 metres was always going to suit her, and she was very strong through the line. Look, he is a wonderful export into the Sydney industry, absolutely. And I don't know about how well they'll be feeling about Storm Boy, those that fronted up with a massive amount of money for him. Look, he didn't get any favours. James was sort of obligated to be where he was, and the horse wouldn't settle. He reefed and teared. It'd be interesting whether they just up sticks, go to the paddock, come back for the three-year-old year now, or quite what they do. He's clearly a better horse than we saw again on Saturday.
Yeah, he is, and it's been a long campaign, hasn't it? With some high-pressure races, so we'll wait to hear what they decide to do with him. We're going to get you off to a break here on Weigh In. On the back of that, we check in and get Butch's top five horses, his Kiwi exports, on the back of this.
West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountains, Shenandoah River.
Today's Weigh In is brought to you by our stable of sponsors.
But he's giving the Wonder Mare 8 lengths. Sunline given the rein at the 350. Slipped 2 lengths in front. Adam New Trump sticks on. Here comes Fairy King Prawn. It's Sunline in front. Fairy King Prawn, the horse of Hong Kong, coming after the Mare of the World. 150 to go. Sunline's a length in front. Fairy King Prawn trying to get him. Sunline, the Kiwi pulling out, stops. Fairy King Prawn lifts. They come to the line. Fairy King Prawn dives, but he missed. Sunline, the Mare of the World, wins it from Fairy King Prawn.
Oh, great stuff. The Mare of the World, wasn't she just an absolute sensation? And the reason that we have a look at that replay is because, Butch, she features heavily in your top five Kiwi expats.
Yeah, she does. She's at the top of the list. That was phenomenal. I know someone that was there that day, and they said that the whole crowd just started screaming, prawn, 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 as he came at her, and the horse of Hong Kong versus the mare of the world, and the mare of the world was too good in the finish. So yeah, she was just something about her. I was lucky enough to see her race a few times, and she was phenomenal. Rough Habit, wow, that last Stradbroke, I don't think I've ever seen anything like that, when he just steered his own way to the inside fence and then burst through Bone Crusher. Well, all of those things about it.
What does Imperatrice have to do to feature in your top five?
Well, I think the thing is, I suppose, she's still going, isn't she?
Yeah, true.
So, so you know, she comes out and wins an Everest, she'll just jump right in there somewhere,
okay,
won't she?
Okay. Yeah. We'll keep this going next season, maybe.
Yeah, so, look, those horses, a lot of them bring back memories of a time when I was falling in love with thoroughbred racing. So, yeah, pretty special.
Yeah, let's keep it international and head back to Hong Kong. But it's to watch a more recent replay. This is Lucky Swainess taking out a Group 2. Nice effort it was as well. This is a 16th career win in the Sprint Cup. Hugh Bowman doing the riding. He's been a great horse, hasn't he?
Yeah, he sure has. Been a phenomenal horse ever since he went through that ready-to-run sale. And he's had a few riders, but Hugh Bowman able to get the best out of them, out of him here. He mightn't be at his absolute best again, but wonderful to see him back winning a Group 2 race. And I'm sure that they've got a Champions Night coming up, haven't they, or Champions Day coming up. There'll be a sprint that he'll be awfully competitive in.
Yeah, they will. Great horses, sir, and doing great stuff for the Kiwis up in Australia, in Hong Kong. Let's get to some race markets, because they're coming up. Of course, we have day two of the championships, and there's a number of Kiwis represented. We'll start with the Australian Oaks. That's the first one that we look at. And obviously, Orchestral is right at the top of the book. Spoke to Robert Wellwood this morning. He said Orchestral is spot on. They elected to gallop her on Sunday, not Saturday, due to waiting to find out if the races were going to be abandoned. James McDonald came in and rode her, and he was very, very chuffed with her. So really exciting to have her in there. Quintessa also features in that market as well.
Yeah, James would be nearly as chuffed as anyone that got on at $11 there, the opening price,
yes,
into $1.90. She'll be better for that run, you would think, in the Vinery. So, yep, she's going to be awfully hard to beat.
Yeah, she is. And there's plenty to look forward to when it comes to that race day. Obviously, the Queen Elizabeth, the Queen of the Turf, and the Sydney Cup all to come. Maharajan, Campionessa, a couple of Kiwis that are going to be doing their thing across the ditch. Butch, it's been great to have you on the show. We've loved every minute of it. And, yeah, we'll look forward to seeing you again.
Look forward to it. I know it's a thoroughbred show, but if you're looking for something to do Friday in Cambridge, it's a hell of a night. The Race by Grins and the TAB Trot. Dave Branch and the team do a great job. So get along and enjoy the other code, the sister code. Should be a great night.
Yeah, it will be. Well, that's it from us here on Weigh In. Next week, we can review all the action from day two of the championships, plus our domestic racing here in New Zealand.
I set out to get you with a fine-tooth comb. I was soft inside. There was something.